Keith, we're getting in to about a minute before launch. This looks good to you, or we shall see.
Yeah, like I said, our first attempt, I got that launch feeling. There's something about, you know, it's completely mystical. No math, no rocket science. I just got the impression.
This is where your astrology comes in.
Yeah, there you go. All right. I've got another career.
See, I was right after all.
Yeah.
Hey, listen, we just are now 22 seconds until we see the launch here of Blue Origin. It's been a rough week trying to get this off the launch pad. Cape Canaveral, Florida, getting ready for another attempt of its flagship New Glenn rocket. Let's listen in.
T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7. Three, two, one. Lift up detected.
Self motion.
New Glenn has cleared the tower. And the roll strip's now level.
Oh, beautiful.
50 seconds into flight. Continue to see good engine operating parameters. All set.
A clean burn. We're coming up here on max Q, maximum dynamic pressure. This is the hardest point on the vehicle when it comes to the pressures and the speed. We want to see this rocket punch through.
Good QC control, good MR control. 1 minute, 15 seconds in. Now passing Mach 1, New Glenn is now supersonic.
Supersonic, and we can hear the
1 minute, 30 seconds. Engine operating parameters continue to look good at full thrust. Max Q, maximum dynamic pressure.
All right, there you have it. We're going to continue to monitor, but Blue Origin launched its flagship New Glenn rocket from Cape Canaveral today, just moments ago, a crucial test for Jeff Bezos' space company in his quest to challenge Elon Musk's SpaceX. The rocket, 320 feet tall, thundering off that launch pad at 3:55 p.m. New York time. It is sending to Rocket Lab made spacecraft on a trajectory toward Mars to study how solar winds interact with the planet's atmosphere. This mission called Escapade is the rocket's second flight ever and its first for NASA.
We're over 2 minutes into the time that it has been in the air after liftoff. We have passed max Q. I want to bring in American astrobiologist and editor of NASAWatch.com, Keith Cowing, joining us from Reston, Virginia. Keith, max Q. A very important test when it comes to any launch. Remind everybody what it is and what a craft experiences at max Q.
That's when the rocket's speed and the air it's fighting against and everything else come together, and you have to dial down the engines a bit to get through that point. But there's one thing when you watch camera shots like this, and again, it's not rocket science. This is a pretty rocket. It's straight. It's solid. There's no wobbling. The engines are perfect. And so right off the bat, I give it, you know, a 10 out of 10 just for performance. Now, we're coming up in about 3 minutes or so where we're going to have the stage separation. That's where the rubber really hits the road. Because the second, okay, engine shut down. Now we're going to have staging. You'll see that on the camera feed. And the important stuff for this rocket is actually on the top of the second stage. So launching is one part. Putting the payload where it needs to go is another. And we have staging. All right, still looking like a pretty mission. But now the cool part is the first stage is going to do a flip around and come back and land on a barge named after Jeff Bezos' mother. That should be interesting. And if you're watching the feed, you're getting a nice clear shot down at the Earth.
Both B3U engines continue to look good. Body rate response is normal. Seeing good data coming down from both stages.
Great data.
Okay.
4 minutes into NG2.
No, the payload fairing has gone off the top of the second stage. That's important because now the payloads are up there ready to go to be deployed a bit down the road. But now we're, I think everybody's really watching to see how the first stage comes in and lands.
We're watching that, Keith. We're also watching the closing bell just seconds away here in New York City, taking a look at how stocks performed on this day. We're still waiting for things to settle, but downside. Down day, 2.3% to the downside on the NASDAQ composite. The S&P 500 down 1.6%. The Dow down 1.6% as well. The Dow losses today, just about 800 points to the downside. The S&P 500 fell 113 points. The NASDAQ composite down 536 points.
Yeah, basically heavy selling resuming on Wall Street on this Thursday, halting a week-long respite spurred by the U.S. government reopening as hawkish statements from Federal Reserve officials ahead of a deluge of economic data spurred traders to dump risky assets. So that's what we've seen. So concern about valuations once again among investors and traders, a sell-off in particular in those high-flying tech giants. Bitcoin sinking below $100,000. The yield on that 10-year climbing 4 basis points to 4.11%. Traders pricing in about even odds that the Fed will cut rates come December.
I want to get back to our coverage of the new Glenn mission timeline right now. 5 minutes and 40 seconds since launch. So here we are, Keith Cowing. Three-engine booster reentry burn is roughly the next thing we're going to see. That should happen at 6 minutes and 48 seconds. At plus an hour and 42 minutes, that's the end of the mission. Between now and then, what are the most important milestones to watch for?
Well, now we have two separate things going on. We have the first stage, which has done its job. So although it's going to do something cool, we can put that aside because it's the second stage with the spacecraft, the payloads. That's where the real focus is right now, because last time the second stage didn't quite do its thing. So now it's got to do something perfectly and then go into a certain orbit, come around again, and then let loose these two spacecraft to go in there into a special orbit around Earth. So there's a lot of rocket science and whatnot still to come. But just as they're getting ready to do that, this other stage is going to come in. What this shows is that this rocket is reusable because you can get the first stage back, which to Blue Origin is a very important milestone as well. So this is one of those missions where everything is important and everything is, in many cases, the first time they've ever done it.
And I got to say, for something that we watch here at Bloomberg, I mean, keep in mind that, you know, Blue Origin, we've covered a lot, you know, has been sending tourists to the edge of space and back on smaller rockets. What's key about New Glenn is that it's giving the company the capability to deliver spacecraft and satellites into orbit and beyond. And it makes New Glenn key to clearing Blue Origin's $10 billion backlog of customer contracts. So, you know, yes, it's cool to see, cool to watch, certainly, Keith, right? But it is also a business, and it's something SpaceX has been, you know, involved very much heavily in the government, but Blue Origin wants a piece of that too.
Yeah, and this is a hybrid thing going on here. I mean, you've got several rich guys who have more money than some countries do to spend on space. They read too much space science fiction growing up, and they don't know any better than to make it happen. But that's not enough to make the payroll every Friday. So you got to go out and get business. And, you know, the thing that goes with these rockets is the more you can launch, the more people want to launch, and it sort of feeds back. So you're always going to seemingly need more rockets to launch more payloads. So the trick is to get in now and at least try and hold off SpaceX from being in complete, you know, control of the launch market and get a piece for Blue Origin. And based on how this rocket's working now, I think they've got a good shot at becoming the other player.
But Keith,
Avis versus Burns,
the other player, and that's key here. And there are some other smaller companies as well, some publicly traded, Rocket Lab, well, USA, for example.
Is this the rocket? Let's go back. The rocket coming back down, correct? Go ahead, Keith. This is crazy.
You're in New York City. Imagine a building across the street that's like 30 stories tall took off. Now it's coming back to
land.
Really?
Yeah. The rocket going through the clouds, but it's back coming to Earth. And this whole idea of these rockets being reusable and coming back down to Earth and hitting, back to its, I don't think it goes back to the launch pad, but there is certainly a spot that, there it goes.
It's on a floating barge. We're coming to a floating barge.
For those listening, go ahead, Keith.
They're about to do something the first time that it took SpaceX a bunch of times to do. Well, let's watch. If it comes down and lands, that's a world record.
You can hear the crowds that are there in Cape Canaveral, the excitement. For those who are listening on radio, Keith, what's happening right now? Keith, what's happening?
Well, the rocket landed and the barge, it's standing there. There's all kinds of crap all over the lens, which I guess they should have guessed would happen. And it's clearing, and look at that. This SpaceX had to do this a bunch of times to get it right. They got it right the first time.
What does that say about what's going on at Blue Origin? I mean, that significance. And right now we're showing just tons of folks there
and,
on the ground.
And likely a lot of employees at the company.
Well, it shows you that, you know, it's not just one company that could do this, that it's rocket science is something that's ubiquitous. NASA is to really be congratulated on this, because what we're seeing now is American companies taking stuff that was pioneered by NASA, given to the private sector, and they're making it even better than the basic stuff that NASA did. And they can now do things that NASA really can't do, which is sort of what NASA wanted in the first place.
Keith, for somebody watching or listening right now, they might say, wait a second, I've seen SpaceX do this many times over the last 5 years, 6 years.
Yeah.
Why did it take Blue Origin so long to catch up?
Well, here's the thing. Their rocket, you know, they're different. It's tortoise and the hare. NASA, you know, SpaceX would launch things and it would blow up and they'd say, hey, that looked cool. And they'd have a blooper reel. But they were big into launch and test. Blue Origin was a little more conservative about this. But here's the thing. Like I said, when SpaceX landed on a barge, they crashed a whole bunch of times before they did it perfectly the first time.
But now it's routine.
But this time, Blue Origin landed the very first time they wanted to land on that barge and tried to, they landed. So that shows you that they've got something out of the gate that SpaceX didn't have. But at the end of the day, it's how often you can launch these things, what's the profit margin, how much money do they need to get back out of this, and how are they going to compete with each other, and how is the rest of the world going to respond? That's going to be the interesting thing.
Well, Keith, the other part of this is it's news because Blue Origin accomplish something that they've never done before. It's not news when SpaceX does this, because SpaceX does this day in and day out. At what point do you think in the timeline here will this no longer be news for Blue Origin?
Well, I would make jokes about SpaceX, like they would miss the landing by 3 inches, and that even got old for a while. But to me, the headline is man bites dog, is that SpaceX has competition. And it has competition in a whole new arena. Oh, by the way, Rocket Lab built the satellites that's being launched. Rocket Lab has its own ability to launch.
That's what I was saying. SpaceX already has competition in the form of Rocket Lab USA, at least for launching some of the low Earth orbit satellites. Yeah.
You're watching, you know, this is akin to, you know, back in the 30s with Pan Am and then other companies learning how to do intercontinental flights with propeller airplanes. And then after World War II, they went to jets. You're watching, and of course, it's turbocharged by the fact that it's rockets and everything. But you're watching a whole new industry just build itself in plain view in front of our own eyes. And it's not even reached the cusp of what it could do yet. So more to come.
I'm not looking at X right now, but I'm curious what's going on in Elon Musk's head when he sees something like this.
Elon likes competition. I mean, he was sort of like, you know, when Mercedes-Benz allowed the patent for airbags to be used by anybody, he's often said, you can use our stuff. We're more about the rising tide lifts all boats thing. I think he also really appreciates the fact that a growing market means more opportunities for everybody. And the more the competition happens, the more the opportunities show up. So as long as you keep your game up, and you watch the competition, and you try and outdo them and overperform and undercut the costs, you know, it's a dynamic thing. And I don't see Elon as like the kind of guy that likes to sit back and just let the grass grow. And I think he enjoys the competition at the end of the day, even if he complains about it.
Yeah, it definitely revs him up. Hey, listen, before we wrap up here, I do think about how the space program has evolved from, you know, less government, but a lot more the private industry, the space race still on. What's next? What's the next thing you're going to be watching out for?
Well, we need to see. We've come out of the shutdown and the government's coming back, and you know it's going to take a bit to get reoriented. NASA is being pivoted in another direction. We're not sure where. We've got an interim administrator who has a day job, so it's, you know, it's kind of hard to figure out where the space program is going to go. But the new guy, Jared Isaacman, has been into space twice. Mm-hmm. He knows how to make money. He knows how to take the risks, and he knows how to be innovative. And he's one of these people that just grew up with space in his blood. So the trick is going to be how he comes into NASA with his business acumen and his exploration skills and welds that together with decreasing budgets, but an ability to perhaps use the private sector more. He'll probably figure it out, but it's not going to be easy because every time you want to change something, there's a whole bunch of companies and their lobbyists lined up to say, no, you're not going to change this. That's his biggest challenge.